But still, it's on value 2 area if we compare it to 2. Now we discuss the reasons behind the coexistence. Why the coexistence is necessary, or why we not replace the old 2G with 3G if it is better than 2G. First is that the 2G provides the more mobility. Mobility, in fact, is the main issue in a cellular network because users pay for the more mobility. And mobility is related to the coverage. If you have lot of coverage, it means you can provide lot of mobility. Yeah, let it be. See this diagram. 2G has the more coverage as compared to 3G. It means the user of 2G is get more mobility as compared to 3G. So if 3G users move toward 2G, then we need to do something compatible device like dual mode and mobile terminal to facilitate the 3G user into the area for the more mobility or high mobility. The next reason behind our coexistence is that 3G equipment is expensive than 2G. So it's not possible for operator to replace all the 2G with 3G equipment because it must be so expensive and not easy to get enough revenue in a spot. Next is about the low traffic intensity area, not suitable for 3G. 3G is more expensive than say before this. So if we have an area, a large area, but minimum number of users, and if we want to install the whole infrastructure of 3G in this area, then it is not possible for us to generate the enough attrition revenue for this area. So according to business point of view, it is not feasible to install 3G infrastructure in low traffic industry. 3G is only feasible when you expected to get some high number of users for that. If you have high number of users for 3G, then you get more revenue for this area. High number of 2G users, of course, before 3G, we have 2G and all the users belong to 2G. So we can only give them a choice the 2G users if they want to facilitate more high value added services for 3G network, then they will switch from 2G to 3G step by step. But it is not possible for us to force the user for a certain change or certain switch from 2G to 3G. Expensive 3G mobile phone is also a big hurdle for the 2G users. Because if they are certified with 3G and they want to join the 3G network, then they will sacrifice some healthy amount to purchase the 3G phone. My research shows that 60% respondent of people are satisfied with 3G. They are happy with 3G, they enjoy the 3G facilities. But only 8.5% purchase a 3G cell phone, which means only 9% just join after the research 3G. It means still 91% happy with 3G. I hope this number will be increased with the passage of time, but it will take some time. So coexistence is a better solution for that. Dual mode mobile terminal. Yeah. If we want successful coexistence, then we need such a device that is working for both 2G network as well as 3G network. And the solution of this problem is a dual mode mobile terminal. It can work in 2G as well as work in 3G. Here we have a dual mode mobile terminal. You can see that it has three parts. First one is common parts, it's working for both WCDMA and DSM, means 2G and 3G. This portion is specific for WCDMA and that one is specific for DSM. Now, I want to try to explain why the dual mode mobile terminal is necessary for the handover purpose. Now I have an example. Suppose now, right now, this mobile terminal is in 3G region, a WCDMA region. Now we want to move from 3G to 2G region, to GSM. Then what happened with this terminal, or how the dual terminal behave during the handover? Let me suppose it's a tower belonging to the WCDMA. for the GSM, it has the different parameters, they are necessary for the GSM and all that. Now this portion is very much similar if mobile is in GSM and in, and we get the GSM handover message. This message is very similar to that message. Now what happened? This message received from here and they goes to their WCDM account. Now we see what is the function of this part. This part receives that message and extract the whole message. This message received and extract whole message and deliver that JSON part to JSON portion. You can see that extract the whole message, put let this part and pass to the next portion. Now mobile over whole more mobile terminal can understand now he is going to hand over to WCDMA to JSON. That's why the whole more mobile terminal is necessary for the whole distance. Next we have a simulation to operate modular and here we will explain the rest of the business.
We have used a new simulation tool which is OpNet Modeler, and first of all I will give an overview of how it works so that it will be easy to understand how we generate graphs and how we make topologies in this simulation tool. So I'm going to give you an introduction about OpNet. Optimized Network Engineering Tool is a network simulation tool which makes its use easy by providing a graphical user interface. So it will, it's not just like coding and coding and coding in a, some of you guys have written MS2. It's just all coding. It's no graphical user interface on which you can work. It gives a graphical user interface, but you have to make all the quality by coding. But in OpNet, you can just pick the models and put them and make together, and it's going to work like just like a tool. It was actually an MIT project, and initially it was developed for the military, but later it uses for student purposes and some simulations, network simulation tools. OpNet is modeled in three domains. It has a network domain, node domain, and a process domain. I mean, we can, how they are attached to each other, radically attached to each other, is shown in the next video. I'm going to show you a simple simulation and some results for that. And you can see how these are attached to each other. What is the network domain? In network domain, we make networks, topologies, and it handles mobility. And the node domain, in node domain we have routers, workstations, and mobile stations. If we want to make a router, we have to work in that node domain. And what is behind the router? There are different types of processes behind the router. And what are the processes determined and defined in process domain? Emphasis on process and queues. So here we can see, if we take this our topology, or we say it's a network domain, you can see it's just overcome by another figure. So it's a typical UMTS model consisting of SDSM, DGSM, Arena Network Controller, it's the base station, and here are the number of mobile nodes or workstations. And if you just take one workstation, it's the internal construction, you can say, of the workstation. You can see the stack. This stack is just most likely like OSC model stack. I mean, every portion has its own work. And just like layer process, every portion is first come to first layer, and then according to the next layer, it's just converted to processes. And the construction of node is different processes which are attached to each other. And for these processes, there are the coding behind it. We can make changing in it, or if you want to make a new process, we can make it by coding. So this is the coding. It's done automatically. No need to code it. We just make this, define some specifications, and the coding is done behind automatically. And for this, we use a compiler to compile this program, because OpNet don't have its own compiler. So we can use Microsoft Visual, C++, or .NET, or whatever. We can use a compiler to compile this process. So here's the video. It's a typical UMTS model, a network. This is a mobile node, the node B, RNC, and CSM. If we just open it, you can see it's behind run at such a very different. So when I will run a simple simulation, first I will take two parameters. For UMTS handover, I will make a handover, and for this I will check the pilot channel. What is the pilot channel? I will discuss it later in one of my simulation. But it's just like you can see, it's just a power, transmitting power. So I just select it and then click OK and just run the simulation. And it's almost for 25 minutes is the simulation time. And let me just run it. And then the simulation starts. So you can see there's no need to go into long codings and things like that. So it just starts simulating, it's just compiling the program. It's take a long time, but for this I have already then done it in my class before, so no need to do all the process, it's gonna take 10 minutes or more. So yeah, it's simulation is complete now. Now I have to take the results. So just click on that node and click on view results. And then from here you will see the handover results. Here is the pilot channel for the active set. The active cell will be defined later as well. And this is for the cell 0 and this is for the cell 1. So these are the three graphs. Now you can see there are three colors, a green, red and blue. The green one is for this one, this node. The red one is for this node or base station or in case of UMTS, you can say node B. And the blue color. Blue color is the actual power which is received by this, or which is on which power it is attached to the system. So before, because first of all you can see, I will discuss later. At this point, it is near to base station or node B, so we have a maximum power here. Okay. Here the point which will the handover take place. Handover is very important. At this point, the handover take place. Now the cell will start receiving from this node B. At this point, it's at maximum position from this node B, so the red signal is very low and it's near to this one, so the green one or blue one is its maximum transmission power received by this. So it will follow the trajectory, a zigzag, and power control in UMTS network, the power transmission lower and lower, and then it's moving away from that base station and it's going increasing and increasing. And at this place, it's just switched from, and from this point, it's switched to the next base station. So this is the handover. So it's attached at this point, it's attached to just one base station. But if you just check the soft handover, here, it's more visible here than here. When it is here, at this point, it is getting signals, or it is attached to one base station, and at the same time, it is attached to the other base station as well. At this point, it's taking signals from both base stations. So at this point, it is attached to two base stations. So it's very simple to understand. Now we come to the uplink transmission power. The comparison of uplink transmission power between soft and handover, hard handover. Uplink transmission power means the power which is needed for a mobile station to connect to the base station. It's very important in soft handovers because it is a one reason we feel very important to get rid of the near power effect in human GSM operation. This is not done in GSM. So this is a simple scenario. It's just a simple zigzag trajectory between two base stations. And now we will see what is the difference between uplink transmission power. The red line shows, the red dot shows, I told you we have run this simulation twice. One with soft handover and then with the hard handover. So for the hard handover we see the red dots, and for the soft handover we will see the blue dots. So if we see the maximum fast power for hard handover is shown in red, is around about -4 dBm, and for soft handover is around about -6 dBm or something like. So the difference between is 3 dBm. Okay, so we can see that we have, and you know that 3 dBm is almost the double power. So we have reduced the power for the mobile station. So it is very important to reduce the power, because with hard handover it can be make more problem for another user and cause near power effect as well. So these are third simulations. It will be the active cell addition and cell replacement procedure for soft handover. How a new cell is added to an active cell? Active set is, you can just say, if we have receiving signals from many base stations, we cannot just jump on to other. So we have to make a set for that cell which will be reasonable to home, which can take handover, can't take handover of every cell. So the cell which have good signal tonight ratio, we will only switch to that. So it keeps a set for the a good candidate of the cell. So this is just a simple scenario, just a one sender and the receiver, and the trajectory is a straight trajectory. It's just moving towards the first one, and the second and third is passing the second and third one. So the active set is in this simulation, active set is kept two. I mean, at one place, at one point, it can have two cells or two base stations in an active set. We can keep it three or four, whatever we like, but just for this level, we'll just keep it two. And this is the pilot channel signal to noise ratio. And what is the pilot channel signal to noise ratio? Pilot channel is a downlink channel, and it's transmission power is around about 5 to 15 of the total transmission power, and it is used to measure the signal quality. It's not just transmitting the data on that, we just use it to check the signal quality of the new base station. So at the start of the simulation, it is the cell 1, the cell 1 is connected, the base station is at this power, and when we just get start closing to it, the power is increasing, and then the power is decreasing. I think so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then we move away and away, and then cell 2 is added at this point, and at this point the cell the threshold that you can see the value of red curve is getting below the threshold. If we just this how we calculate this, we can see this by if we just go in. There are some equations which are given how we calculate these values. If you just read the thesis, it will describe you how, what are the values to replace a cell. These are the equations, and on here is the diagram here. It will give how we replace a cell, how we add a cell, how we give up a cell. These are the equations which give all these things. So according to these equations, it calculates that whether the power of this cell is not enough to keep it in the cell, so it replaces with a new cell 3. So at this, for delta t, it will measure, and then it, this cell will be added to the active cell. So the cell is replaced here. And if, because it has not done here, but if the cell have enough power, less that it cannot be handed over, so it will be taken away from the active cell. So the next is the delta comparison, and the other thing will be described the problem.
Now we have a solution number 4. It's about the data comparison between the two methods. As you know that the big difference between the two is 3G is the data rate. 3G provides a vital difference, means high data rate as compared to 2G. Now we check the what is the difference between two data rate when over the user switch between two different technologies. First we have a scenario for this simulation. We have a sender and this is receiver. Now, when we run the simulation, the receiver moves from 2G GPRS and then comes back from 3G. On the other hand, sender is static. Now we check what happened when it moved, when we fetch the data rate graph. We have a data rate graph. The red is show the sender data rate, and the blue is show the receiver data rate. This portion start when both are in 3G networks. One thing I want to explain, the red line show the constant data rate, it's average graph. Now, in 3G, everything is okay. That's the point when our user move from 3G to 2G, it's another point. After that, suddenly his data fall, because 2G not supporting the data rate as like 3G. During this period, we have less data rate as compared to 3G. Now it's the point when again handover occurs and our user move in the 3G. When you come back into 3G, then again it sustains again the same receiving rate as you can receive in 3G. Next simulation about the jitter comparison between the UMTS and GPRS. Jitter is the more important parameter for the performance metrics. It tells us how our network is efficient or not. Now we have an interesting simulation scenario for this simulation. Now we have three nodes. This one and this one. Two in a 3G or UMTS and third in a GPRS. Now it make a wide functions call to other. We can make a connection this and this at the same time it make a conference call. Now after function we run the simulation and then we check what is the performance of jitter in the 3G network and what is the performance of jitter in 2G network. Before the simulation we create a background data for the both networks of the same level, of same quantity. Now, it's a result of the jitter for GPRS. It's round about 300 milliseconds. It's a quite high jitter delay. It's a 300 milliseconds at the average. One time we reach around about 320, but the average of 300 milliseconds. On the other hand, that is the jitter for UMTS. You can see that it's around about 42 milliseconds in average. It's look very fluctuation in this graph, but it's not fluctuation. It's a high scale. It's from 42 milliseconds to 43 milliseconds. It's our fluctuation in only 1 millisecond. It shows that there is a difference. In UMTS, the value of jitter jitter or jitter delay is very low as compared to GPRS, because as we know that it depends upon the how your network congestion or how it's efficient or how bandwidth is available for the traveling the data or the packets. So we know that the 3G provides the more bandwidth as compared to GPRS and also have a high data rate. That is why it's efficient for the Wi-Fi as compared to GPRS with a low jitter delay. Now we have some conclusion of our thesis. First is that the coexistence of the 2G and 3G is a good solution for the users and the business point of view. Because for the user it's very easy, it's your choice, you can use 2G as well as you can use 3G, and according to business point of view, it is good to generate the enough revenue as you can from 2G, and then this revenue you can use to replace the 3G infrastructure. Next thing is it's possible to hand over between these two technologies. It's possible to hand over. Next thing is the comparison in data rate when the moving from 3G to 2G or 2G to 3G. It may be user sacrifice and data rate, especially when they move from 3G. Next one is the multi-gig application performance is severely reduced when shift to 2G. Some of them may be your web browsing speed slow when you move from 3G to 2G. Successful configuration of dual mode mobile terminal in using off-net modular. And in the last, we checked the performance metric by the jitter. It's much better in 3G as compared to GPRS. So this is, if you have any question, you can ask.
Configure when we configure the dual mode, then we have been there, but it's not very difficult to do this now.
all the cells. Okay, so all these cells are under observation, so all these are monitor cells. But if it is here, if it have to hand over, it don't hand over to this cell. It will hand over to this cell. So we have to keep an active set to whom which we can make a handover. It's not possible, but it's just simple if you just can't hand, because we are moving on this trajectory and you have a one more here, you can't just hand over here because the trajectory is this. And the level from this is also very less. So we are monitoring all the cells. There are monitored cells, but we can just hand over some cells which fulfill that criteria of the question I showed you before. So the cells which fulfill that criteria, then we put together in a set that will be known as active set, and it can be two or three or whatever in the sort of quantity.
So you mean that if the value crosses the power level crosses the
threshold, yeah. It will get into
it is into the active set. And if not,
it is monitored. It can be maybe in future it's possible to put in active set, but it's not as monitor set but not that. Active set is a combination of
when the case of moving from 3G to 2G, as you showed in your simulations, there were some threshold values as well. So what about a multimedia call or any other similar application? Will the call be dropped while moving from 3G to 2G or not?
It actually depends upon the application. If you are using the web browsing and 3G you have high speed, but in, when you go to or when you hand over to GPRS, then you must have a less speed. Or it's downloading speed, or if you can download an image in 3G in 1 minute, maybe GPRS you can take more than 10 minutes. And if you have a multimedia call, that is a more possibility you will drop the call in GPRS. It's very rare to continue the multimedia call in GPRS. If you are insist on that, you will you want to continue the multimedia call in GPRS, then you use the low bit rate.
Maybe you can just get
black and white, lot of jiggering, and
not possible.
Lot of things. It may be possible, but it's not a good idea.
Here you can see, it's an instrument which want to make a handover, then the coefficients are 2G, 3G, and 4G.
Not from 3G to 4G, it's possible from 2G to 4G.
Yeah.
Because in many areas you are only using the 2G, not 3G.
So you can take the path as well, I mean, you're not used to deploy 4G, 3G.
3G, you
can
just
start
jump
and
4G. 4G.
So you can jump from there.
The path that you showed on the simulation that the guy or the mobile terminal was going, is that like a normal path for a mobile user?
It can be possible, but it's not in radius. Radius not possible. I'm just going like that.
Just check all the parameters, and
it's not a real life scenario, but just to make a scenario so that we can make more handovers and we can get close to the base station and then get from the. So you can in one simulation you can make four handovers. So it just do that. Or you can use just a single handover or two maximums.
Possible to put in a big house and just order two cells.
Yeah, if
you
have a very big villa and you have two cells, so we can take handover, so it's possible.
So they have to make calls?
Yes, please.
You explain this like this is something good that you could go to shoot in 3G. What is bad for doing such a concept? Is there anything that is negative or
for the coexistence?
Yeah.
I have put it in. This is pesky degradation which is done by the coexistence. It's a problem. One may be a critical link which will be uplink for W3 uplink or uplink for 2G. So anyone cannot see that. These are the four results from this. It's not done by ourselves. It's a whole paper, research paper, this is 21. So he told us that you have some capacity degradation done by coexistence. This is only we have found. Maybe we should have some more, but
is there any more questions? Okay.
Done?
Yeah, it's done.
यार ये रिकॉर्डिंग तो हुई नहीं इसकी सर रिकॉर्डिंग का क्वेश्चन किया भूल गया
हमारे लिए उसकी जानकारी तो बता दें तो बता दें
तो भी कर।